Hi guys, welcome to another session of RBI 247. So guys, as you know that in this session we discuss a set of 5 questions that can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So let's not waste any time and move straight away to the session. But before doing that, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if this is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the like, do not forget to hit the subscribe button. And you can also press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to get in touch with us and get notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. Apart from that, guys, if you have any doubts, you can always mention them as comments on the videos. And as you can see, we can try to take them up in the sessions, right? So, are you ready for question number 1 for today? So, moving ahead to question number 1. So, this is your question number 1. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. Okay, so let us read that question. This question says, following are some statements about sovereign guarantee. Select the ones which are correct. So, 4 statements given to you about a topic called sovereign guarantee. And you have to select the correct one out of these 4. Right? Moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the correct option for this question is option E. Option E means only one, right? Only one is correct, rest 3 statements, they are not right. So guys, first of all, let's try to understand this topic of sovereign guarantee. For this, I would like to use an example. For a second, forget that we are witnessing a pandemic and let's assume that everything is normal, right? So since year end is approaching and new year is coming, you want to go on a trip to Goa with your friends. Seems quite unrealistic, but yes, you plan to do it, right? Now there is one of your friend, and this best friend of yours has strict parents. That is why the parents are not allowing your friend to go on a trip. Now what you can do is, you as a person has a very good image with the parents of your friends, and your friend's parents, they think that you are a very nice person, you are a good child and you can take care of their child, right? So what you do is, you go to your friend's home to convince the parents, and finally they get convinced and you guys get to go to Goa, right? So basically, what you are doing here is, you are trying to convince the parents to allow the child, right? For this, you are taking the guarantee, because the parents tell you that if anything bad happens, you are the accountable person and we are going to come to you and you will have to clear up all the mess if any mess is created, right? So basically, you are the thought, you are the person who is taking the guarantee for someone else. In this case, your friend, right? So this same situation can be applied to lenders and borrowers. And how can that be? See, lenders, they have to give their money to borrowers in return for some reward, right? Now obviously, they are going to be concerned about the safety of their money, just as parents are concerned about the safety of their children, right? Now in this case, you as the third party provides a guarantee to parents that if anything wrong happens, then you are there to take care of their child's safety, right? Similarly, in the cases of lenders and borrowers, if there is another party, a third party, which takes the guarantee that if borrower messes up in any situation, then this third party is going to take the responsibility and is going to make good all the losses caused by the default of borrower, right? So this is the process of guarantee. Just as you are giving guarantee for your friend, third parties or the guarantors, they give guarantee for the borrowers to the lenders, right? So this is the situation. Now coming to sovereign guarantee, if this third party is none other than the government, then this guarantee will be known as sovereign guarantee. So basically, sovereign guarantee is nothing but a simple guarantee where the guarantee is being given by the government for the default risk of any other party. Right? I hope now you understand the concept of sovereign guarantee. And let's hope that you get to go to Goa. Okay, coming to the statements. First statement is correct because it is a promise by the government or guarantee taken by government to make good or discharge the liability of a third person in case of his or her default. Right? The statement is right. Moving ahead to the second statement, it is wrong because it says that it is a promise made to government. Rather, it should be opposite. It is a promise made by the government. So, incorrect. Third statement says, sovereign guarantees do not impact the cost of borrowing for the borrower. This is not right. See, because guys, if we come back to our example of the Goa trip, because you are there, you are taking the guarantee. Do you think your friend's parents are going to be lenient on him or her? Yes, obviously, because now they have someone to go to in case of any crisis and they are assured of their child's safety, just as lenders are assured of their money's safety in the case of guarantee, right? As they can go to the guarantor. So, due to your credibility or the trust placed by parents in you, your friend has got permission from the strict parents, right? So obviously it has become easier for the friend to get the permission, just as it becomes easier for the borrowers to take the loan from lenders or to take the permission of taking loan from lenders, right? So that is why sovereign guarantees, they do impact the cost of borrowing. They reduce the cost of borrowing for the borrowers. That is why third and fourth statement both are false, right, or incorrect. So I hope now you understand the question. Moving ahead to the solution, some more information about sovereign guarantee. Okay, here you can see simple guarantee, but not issued by any corporates but by government, right? And it's a contingent obligation. Guarantees need not be reflected on the guarantor's balance sheet. See, since it is a contingent liability, you will be accountable to the parents only if something bad happens. If everything goes by the rules and everything goes good, then you have nothing to be worried of. Same in the case of guarantor, right? If the party for whom the guarantee has been taken does not mess up or makes good all the payments that he is required to do, then there is no responsibility of guarantor. So that is why taking guarantee is a contingent liability. It might or might not arise, right? So that is why it need not be reflected on the guarantor's balance sheet. Now, rating agencies, when they rate an organization, they try to see that what is the amount of contingent liability. So see, it is not reflected on balance sheet, but it is obviously mentioned in the footnotes, because you got to inform your investors that yes, we have taken the guarantee for this certain borrowers or of this certain amount. That is why rating agencies, they take into account, they use this as a parameter. They say that okay, if one financial institution has taken a lot of guarantees for a lot of borrowers, that means they can be at risk if the guarantee amount is substantial, right? So that is why a part of rating agencies assessment. And it is not, see, so one guarantee, why does government extend it? What are the purposes? First of all, to get into social and economic projects. So for example, government wants to build a dam. For this, they provide the contract to a contractor. So for that contractor to raise loan cheaply in the market, because if it is backed by government, if the lenders know that if contractor does not pay, the government is going to make good all the losses, in that situation it will be easier for the lender to raise money, right? So it helps government to carry on with developmental projects which might need government backing, right? Especially under public-private partnership, where the private sector find it easier to raise loan if public sector backs it, right? After that, to enable public sector companies to raise resources at lower interest charges or more favorable terms, as I just told you that cost of borrowing is reduced. And after that, to fulfill the requirement in cases where sovereign guarantee is a prerequisite. So in many lending borrowing agreement, guarantee can be prerequisite. Lenders might require that, okay, we need guarantee from the certain institution, and to fulfill that, government might step in and take the sovereign guarantee. Guys, here I would like to ask you a question. You have to tell me that if sovereign guarantee is currently in news because of Air India. So you have to tell me what is the connection between Air India and sovereign guarantee, right? So I expect to see a lot of comments on the video. Moving ahead to next question. So here is your second question for today, and this question says, a dash is a type of asset-backed security by a holder of a FAME-based intellectual property right. Basically, a financial instrument issued by someone who holds some sort of intellectual property rights. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question. And the correct option for this question is option D. Option D means celebrity bonds. Seems like an interesting concept. Okay. Celebrity bonds. Now, what are celebrity bonds? I think the name tells you that somehow it is connected to the celebrities. Now, if there is a celebrity, let's say there is a very famous film star, or let's say there is a musician, right? So let's say there is a band called Coldplay, and the lead vocalist of Coldplay needs to raise money somehow, right? So for that he can issue bonds in the market, just as an entity does it. The lead vocalist of Coldplay is going to issue bonds in the market. And see what and for all the people who are going to buy these bonds, he is going to provide some sort of interest. And from where this interest is going to come? Let's say he needs that money, and he can back it up with the royalty that he is getting for his music albums currently. He can use that money to pay the interest, and he can raise a substantial amount of money which he needs for any purpose, right? So that is celebrity bonds. Basically, that person has some music albums or has some intellectual property, has some copyright on which he is earning royalty. And with the use of this royalty, the interest payments on the bonds are going to be made. That allows that particular celebrity, that particular artist to raise money, right? So this is the concept of a celebrity bond. Okay. Issuers of celebrity bonds, they receive money upfront from the investors in exchange for proceeds from future royalties. The royalties that they are going to get in future from their works, they use that money to pay the interest, right? Which are covered by the intellectual property rights listed in the security. Basically, they have their intellectual property, they have their copyrights backing the bonds. Can be backed by any type of work of art that generates royalties. Can be music albums, can be some sort of movies, can be artworks like paintings or books, right? One example of asset-backed securities is music-based securities. In this, celebrity bonds tend to put together the intellectual property of one or more artists whose songs or albums have already stood the test of time. So basically, they are huge celebrities, not an upcoming or a fresher one, but the celebrities who have already an established name in the world. One notable example is Bowie bonds. What are these? Here you can see. Basically, they were issued in 1997 by an investment banker known as David Pullman. So it's a very interesting story where this investment banker constructed a new security called celebrity bonds, and he helped this English singer David Bowie to raise some money, right? And since he had some music albums on which he was getting royalties from 25 albums, about 287 songs, Bowie forfeited the royalties from the albums for the life of the bonds. So life of the bonds backed by the royalties. However, he kept the ownership of the albums, right? So the ownership stays with the music artist, as you can see here. Raised some money which he needs urgently for some purpose, and then provides interest, as you can see, for 10 years. 10 years was the life of bond, 7.9% interest to the bond holders, right? So this is the concept of a celebrity bonds. So moving ahead to the next question for today. Okay, so here is the third question. This was mentioned by one of you in the comments. I hope this question helps you. On November 18, 2020, the Chinese government issued debt denominated in dash currency. Very simple question. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question. And the correct option for this question is option B. Option B means euro. So Chinese government issuing euro denominated securities. Right? Seems a bit strange. So why is a huge country like China issuing euro denominated bonds? And apart from that, one specific feature of this bond is that they are providing negative interest rate. Guys, if you remember, we have already studied about negative yield bonds, the bonds which provide a negative return to the investor, in one of the previous sessions. If you haven't watched it, you can ask for its link in the comments, right? So China is issuing negative interest rates. One reason behind issuing negative interest rates is the ultra low interest rates which are getting popular all over the world. You can see that central banks all over the world, they are busy creating liquidity. That is why they are trying to pull the rates down, so that they can ease the cost of borrowing and they can stimulate the economy by pulling down the cost of borrowing and allowing business to expand and provide employment, right? Now, two significant features: euro denominated bonds and negative interest rates bonds. So let us learn some more things about this. Okay, so star of this issuance, 750 million euros of zero coupon bonds. So first of all, these bonds are zero coupon bonds, which means they are not going to provide any interest rate to the bondholder. So if you are buying these bonds, you are buying, usually what happens in a zero coupon bond is that, let's say if the bond is worth rupees 100, it is issued at rupees 90. That means, let's say this is a 1 month bond. You are buying the bond for rupees 90, and after 1 month you get rupees 100. So the difference of rupees 10 is your reward for buying the bond. This is known as zero coupon bond because there is no interest provided to you, only the difference between the price at which you bought and the price at which bonds are getting redeemed is your reward. So this is the concept of zero coupon bonds, right? So these bonds issued by China, these are also zero coupon bonds, but the catch here is that these bonds are being sold at a price which is higher than the price at which it is going to be redeemed, right? As you can see that they have issued bonds denominated in euro, zero coupon bonds, five year maturity at a price of 100.763. So 100.763, usually in zero coupon bond the purchase price is less than the face value, but here the purchase price at which it is being issued, the issue price is higher than the face value. Basically, you are now buying the bond for 100.763 and you will be getting 100 rupees back. So you get, so basically you are bearing a loss. And in this, we have not done calculations for inflation. We have not done calculations for the reward that you should get, right? So basically here it seems like a loss of 0.763, but it must be, actually it must be higher than that, because we are not considering inflation in this, right? So But still, these bonds have got a very good response, and there are investors who are looking to buy these Chinese bonds. Why is this so? Because see, first of all, I told you that central banks all over the world are busy creating liquidity that has pulled down the interest rates. So that is why bonds, as they provide safety. See, many investors might be thinking, what if we get a loss of more than this, what we are getting at this, right? So here loss is limited and let's invest in this. Otherwise, otherwise it might be possible that we invest in some other investment avenue where we have to face a much bigger loss. That is why this is one factor they are willing to buy these negative yield bonds. For more purposes of buying negative yield bonds, you can watch that session in which we discussed it in detail, right? So coming to the other points, here you can see bond is issued at negative nominal yield of 0.15%, that excludes inflation. Yield hungry investors, so basically investors who are yield hungry, who want the safety of their money, are queuing up to buy this bond. Because see, if they buy German bonds, they are facing a higher loss of about 0.50% on German bonds. So that is why in front of that, this much loss looks like a cake. So, and China is thinking, why has China issued these bonds in euro? Because see, if the euro weakens over the redemption period, they will redeem with fewer renminbi. Renminbi is the currency of China. So China is thinking that we are hedged in both the cases. If euro weakens, if the value of euro falls in comparison to renminbi, obviously they would have to spend lesser renminbi in order to pay their dues which are denominated in euro. And if euro strengthens, if euro gains value till the redemption period, then obviously they would have to spend more renminbi, but they have the benefit of printing more renminbi because renminbi is China's own currency. They cannot print more euro to cover their dues, but they can obviously print more renminbi to pay off their dues in euro. And obviously if euro weakens, then it reduces the burden of Chinese government, right? So this is about China's negative yield bonds. Moving ahead to the fourth question. So here is the fourth question for today. This question says, select the correct statement regarding stop loss order. So here we are discussing a term from the stock market, and let's see what the correct option is. You can pause the video here, you can read the statements carefully and then decide with your answer. The correct option for this question is option A. Option A means this option, which says a stop loss is designed to limit an investor's loss. So what is the purpose of a stop loss order? It limits the loss of an investor on a security position that makes an unfavorable move. Let's try to understand the meaning of stop loss. For a second, just forget this definition. We will come back to it, right? See, in simple terms, stop loss is a facility that allows you to carry out a trade according to the limit that you set up. Let's take an example for that. It will be easier to understand. Let's say there is a share that you are buying at rupees 100, right? So you have bought a share at 100. Now, it is expected that the value of this share is going to fall, and you don't know whether to hold it or whether to sell it, because expectations might go wrong, and if you sell it at lesser price, then you might face some loss. Let's say you sell it at 95 once it starts falling, and then after falling for some time it gains value and reaches to 110. In this situation you are going to face a loss. But what if the value keeps falling and falling and falling, and you do not sell the bond in expectations of it gaining value, right? In that situation also you are going to face a loss. So basically, to limit your loss, see, investors are usually emotionally attached to their investment, although there is no place of emotions in investment, but any person who takes who takes up a position in stock market is somehow working according to their emotional intelligence also. And investors have a tendency that if they invest in a certain share, certain security, they don't want to sell it easily. They want it to gain price, they want it to gain value and then earn on it, right? So sometimes this love for investment, it does not allow investors to sell any security when it is losing value, right? And then it leads to more losses. So for solving this problem, stop loss is a facility that can be used. For example, you can set a limit of rupees 90. Basically, according to the stop loss, you set a limit, and let's say you have set a limit of 90. Now, if this share that you bought at 100, if it falls till the value of 90, when it will touch 90, it will automatically generate a selling order for it and it will be automatically sold, right? So your loss is restricted to 10. If it gains value, then it doesn't matter, then it is not going to execute this sell order. But if it falls, then when it touches 90, then your shares are going to be sold, right? So that you do not bear a loss of more than 10 rupees, right? So this is the stop loss facility. Now, what is the disadvantage? Obviously, if it comes down to, let's say, 90 and it comes down to the price of 88. You sold it when it touched 90. Now after touching 88, it suddenly rises in value and reaches to 110. In this case, obviously, if you would have hold it till it became 110, then you might have earned something. In this case, you bought at 100, sold at 90. But see, what if it kept falling and let's say reached to a level of 70? Then in this case, your loss is limited, right? So loss is limited, but profit opportunities are also limited. You cannot, this facility allows you to limit your losses. Now you can come back to the statement. You can say that it is designed to limit an investor's loss on a security position that makes an unfavorable move. See, if it is rising in the value, then obviously it is not, the stop loss is not going to be executed, it is not going to be implemented. But in the situation, your security starts making an unfavorable move or it starts to reduce in value, then when it will touch the limit, it will automatically be sold. So if it starts to make an unfavorable move, then this stop loss facility is going to limit the loss, right? That is why this is the correct option. I hope you understand the concept. Moving ahead, you can see some more details about it. Okay. Here you can see order is placed with a broker to buy or sell specific stock. It can also be in the case of buying a stock. Reaches a certain price, right? Stop loss is designed to limit investors' loss. Most important benefit is that it costs nothing to implement. Obviously, because if the security prices is rising, then it does not affect you. It's like an insurance. It's like a free insurance for your security, so that at least you are getting rupees 90 for the share or for the security that you bought at 100. Additional benefit is it allows decision making to be free from emotional influences. People tend to fall in love with the stock that we just discussed. And one advantage is you don't have to monitor how a stock is performing on a daily basis because you have set up the limit of 90, right? You set limit, you can leave it on autopilot. One disadvantage is obviously a short-term fluctuation in stock's price could activate a stop price. As I just told you that it might fall to 88 and then suddenly move to 110 and stay there for a long time. So if there is a sudden fall, then stop loss is going to get executed and then many of your profit-making opportunities might die out, right? Moving ahead to the next question for today. Here is the fifth question. And this question says that Paneer Singh Tikka is an investor in stock market. He is a very busy man. He is looking for a facility with the help of which he can set the start and end limits of his trade. Could you help him? Right. So this is something really similar to stock loss order, and the correct option for this question is option E. Option E means stop limit order. Right? Now stop limit order. It is quite similar to stop loss order, but the point is here two transactions are involved. You have to select two limits. One is the stop limit and one is the stop order and one is the limit order. Here two terms, two limits that you set are involved. So basically stop order is a point where you want to start a trade. Guys, see, the main difference between stop limit and stop loss and stop limit is that in stop loss you can select a particular point, whereas here you can select a range in which you want to carry out your transaction, right? For example, if we continue the example that we were talking about in the previous question, 100 rupees stock you bought, right? Set a limit of 90. And see, if you don't want to sell this share for too low, you can select another limit of 85. Now your range of transaction is 90 to 85. That means, let's say 90 is the start limit, 90 is the stop limit, and 85 is the limit. So 90 is the stop order, 85 is the limit order. That means if the value of security falls and then it touches 90, then it starts to look for trade for selling it. And obviously it might be possible that you are looking for rupees 90 and no one is willing to buy at 90. That is why you have to reduce the price. But you do not want the price to be reduced more than 85. That is why you set an end limit of 85. That means if someone is willing to buy this stock between 85 to 90, obviously the system would try to get a higher price, the highest price it can get in the range, then the trade is going to be executed. But if no one buys it between this limit, then your trade is not going to be executed. That means it is not going to be sold below 85, right? So basically you can set a range, you can set a stop order, and you can set a limit order. That is why it is known as a stop limit order, right? Here you can see stop limit order is a conditional trade over a time frame. So basically this limit has to be set for a particular time frame. That combines the feature of stop with those of a limit. Basically, you are stopping the trade, you are stopping the fall, you are stopping the loss, but putting a limit to it to mitigate the risk, right? It allows traders to have precise control, more control than a stop loss order. Two limits you have to set, two orders you have to set, stop order and limit order. The start of the specified target price and the outside of the price target for the trade. I think we have discussed all this. Stop order is filled at the market price after the stop price. So stop price was 90 in our case, in our example. So it will start finding buyers after 90 has been hit. And then regardless of whether price changes to an unfavorable position. This can lead to trades being completed at less than desirable prices should the market adjust quickly. So it might be possible that if there is a steep fall, then you might not get the price that you were wanting for it. But obviously it is not going to go below the limit that you had set. So by combining it with features of limit order, trading is halted once the pricing becomes unfavorable based on investor's limit. So trading is going to start at 90, and after hitting 90 it becomes a limit order, and if no buyer is found and 85 hits, then also trading is going to be halted, right? So this is a stop limit order. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. Till then, You take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and I will see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.